the catechisms not only are giving you, if you were to memorize the Bible, you would memorize what it is you're memorizing, and you have that from a particular context, and it's a very wonderful and helpful thing. It's a lamp to your feet and a light to your pathway. However, the catechisms are putting together the biblical witness, and they're telling you what the Bible teaches. They're interpreting the Bible for you.
Welcome back to Mid-America Reformed Seminary's Roundtable Podcast, a broadcast where the faculty of Mid-America discuss everything from Reformed theology, cultural issues, and all things seminary. This is episode 58. I'm your host, Jared Luchibor. Thank you for joining us. We're rounding out our series on Reformed and Presbyterian Confessions today, which started way back with the Belgic Confession. Our Dutch Reformed brothers tackled the three forms of unity, with Dr. Alan Strange and Dr. Marcus Minninger reflecting on the Westminster Standards, wrapping up today with some thoughts on the Westminster Catechisms.
From the last talks, as the gentleman talked about the Heidelberg Catechism, a catechism is a device or a document that is developed to aid in the instruction of those who are learning the Christian faith. And notice how I put that. Sometimes we tend to think these are tools to instruct children or young people, as we might put that. But of course, while that is the case, because we're always, particularly those who are covenantal in their understanding, instructing our children and our young people, and we've even developed some other documents right out of the Westminster Shorter Catechism, influenced by that, is something that many of you would be familiar with called the Children's Catechism. And that Children's Catechism, which has a loose relationship to the Shorter Catechism, is often these days the first thing that children introduce. But let me just say this, which I think is interesting in our times. I've been for 22 years now on the Board of Great Commission Publications, which is the joint publishing agency of the OPC and the PCA. And we've even used to publish the Children's Catechism just in that form, titled Children's Catechism, with sort of children's art on the cover. We now publish one that has regular looking art, and it's called First Catechism. And the reason we're doing that is because in many places, particularly where we're reaching out, and I don't mean in other countries, I do mean in other countries, but I mean also in this country, many people have had no exposure to anything solidly biblical and gospel. And we don't want to insult somebody in a mission that we may be conducting in New York City or in rural North Dakota, just to pick places. We don't want to insult an adult who is really learning the rudiments of the faith and could actually benefit from that first catechism, what's called the children's. He's not ready, he or she, for various reasons, they've evidenced that they're not quite ready for the shorter catechism. So we can give them that and be respectful and treat them in a dignified manner. All this is to say, though, my friends, you are probably listening, you may well be listening on your phone or a laptop. Never has so much information, never have so many resources been so accessible in the history of the world, but never have we been so diffuse in our focus. Never have we been so unclear in our thinking about what truth is. And so catechisms are really invaluable tools for use in the church, for use in the families, for use in the schools. They go across our institutions. I'm thinking particularly of Christian schools. I don't think public schools wish to adopt such. But at any rate, they're invaluable to train people, to help people. My children who learned the shorter catechism, well, we did do some work in the children's, but that wasn't, we tended to focus more on the shorter. they can still answer some things from the Shorter Catechism, and it just gives a focus in theological discussion. So,
well, I tell you, I mean, I use the Catechism still that I memorized at different stages growing up.
Right.
Actually, I always can't. Sometimes I can't initially remember if it's something I memorized from the children's or something I memorized later from the Shorter. But I think the question and answer format of a catechism is so valuable for pedagogically because it's placing important questions and then giving you answers that you can memorize and you can go back over them again and again in your own life and thought. They can be there when you're talking to somebody else in the church who a topic comes up and you just remember the language of the catechism or in apologetic contexts and your kids, my kids aren't going to automatically on their own know what the answer to what is justification, except that they've been taught to memorize it. And I can say to them in family worship or in other contexts, or they can say to somebody else, well, justification is a gift of God's free grace, et cetera, right? So it's a beautiful format, which is part of what you're saying in terms of the whole purpose of catechisms.
And of course, sometimes our friends in evangelical churches raise the question, why do you need to memorize man's word? Why don't you just memorize the Bible? Well, we don't want to downplay the significance of biblical memory. I don't think it's an either or.
Sure.
There's an important place for biblical memory. But one of the things I told my children when they were asking this question, why do I have to memorize? And I say, oh, so you want to memorize a lot of the Bible? And they didn't want to necessarily memorize anything. But the point was, I said, because the catechisms not only are giving you, if you were to memorize the Bible, you would memorize what it is you're memorizing, and you have that from a particular context, and it's a very wonderful and helpful thing. It's a lamp to your feet and a light to your pathway. However, the catechisms are putting together the biblical witness, and they're telling you what the Bible teaches. They're interpreting the Bible for you. And we believe this is very important as Reformed Christians. We don't believe the Word of God is to be an unexposited Word. This is why we think preaching is so very important. And catechisms are of a sort of piece with that. The catechisms, along with the confession, but the catechisms as memory devices are wonderful because they summarize in these capsule ways what the church believes the Bible in its main features to teach. So it really is a significant thing. It's an important thing to be able to memorize and learn. And, you know, I've had folks say, even when they're dealing with on the spot, maybe people standing on their doorstep from the Church of the Latter-day Saints, or our friends in the Jehovah's Witnesses. These folks are there, and they said, I have found the catechism very helpful at points because they've raised very specific points about Jesus as God. And if I know this, you know, here's a wonderful way. And I've had people say, where did you get that from? Is that in the Bible? You know, they're a little nonplussed because they're hoping that these strong affirmations of Jesus' deity are not in the Bible. But at any rate, this is the usefulness of them. And the Shorter Catechism was developed after and separately from, but consonant with, the Confession of Faith. And it was for memory. The Larger Catechism was sometimes put over against the Shorter, which was the weaker sort, those who could take meat. Yes, it's a fuller expression done at the same time, but really used for and intended for teaching. We know that in a general way. And of course, as things have played out in the history of our churches, it is the case that even in many churches where the children learn the Shorter Catechism, the Larger Catechism is scarcely ever mentioned. I sometimes joke and say it's the ugly stepchild of the Reformation. And I happen to be right now myself preaching through it in the evening service, using it as a kind of guide and as I select scripture to instruct the congregation. It's interesting because Philip Schaff speculated, the church historian of some note, speculated that the larger catechism was produced by the divines for the purpose of preaching. Well, there's not, I've looked into this as best I can, and I've found no evidence of that. But it certainly is an excellent teaching tool that the minister or someone well qualified could open up to the people of God. Now, as I just mentioned, I have been in some of our second services, as is the case with the tradition from our friends on the continent, where the second service, it's believed. I think the URC Church Order gives a strong statement to it, and other Reformed Church Orders mention it, that it's appropriate in the second service to have instruction, in the case of our continental friends, from the Heidelberg Catechism. And I found the larger catechism to be very helpful. Richard Knodel did have an article some years back in Ordained Servant. I didn't look up the particular reference, but you can look it up, where he talks about catechetical preaching, and he acknowledges that catechetical preaching is something that the continental brethren have done, not so much the Scottish brethren, though he speaks about it using both the shorter and the larger and some resources for that. But whether you take that approach or not, there are many Presbyterians who convictedly don't think catechism preaching, which I should say isn't preaching the catechism simply, it's preaching God's word and using the catechism appropriately to that, to organize and to structure the sermon. But that some sort of use of it is really helpful in the church. And particularly, again, this you might say is meat. And it's a document that easily lies unused. And as Dr. Menninger said earlier, one of its glories, you might say, and I know some people who have said things like, and I can appreciate it, some people have said things like, it's exposition of the commandments, which it typically will ask at least, what is the third commandment? What is the fourth commandment? And some of the commandments, it has a number of questions that come under it because of the nature of the commandment. But it always says in some fashion, what are the duties required by this commandment? So a commandment, for example, to obey your parents. What are the duties of that commandment? Then what are the sins forbidden in that commandment? And someone has said to me about some of this, this has more in it than one could have ever imagined this commandment was addressing. I will say this, if you are feeling particularly holy, like that monk I read about once who felt as if the holiness, or rather the humility he had been pursuing, he had attained, and he stopped and said, I realized in that moment I was perhaps the most humble man in Europe, if not to say in all of Christendom. if you're feeling rather proud, read the larger catechism on the ninth commandment. And of course, the ninth commandment is, thou shalt not bear false witness against thy neighbor, and you will be laid low. And that's not a bad thing. It both convicts us of our sin, and then it makes us aware, if we have no escape, that there is only one who ever kept the law. That's what I get when I read these commandments. If you think you're a lawkeeper, you're undeceived by this exposition. And you know there was only one who ever kept the law, and the only hope that you have is to be in faith union with him.
I think that some of the things that are involved where the catechism that makes it so fulsome, and in a good sense, and I understand that some people can say, well, you know, is this overinterpreting in any case, right, in some of the particulars? And those are reasonable questions at times, but there is a fulsomeness to their exposition of the law for a variety of reasons, and one is that it assumes that what the law forbids, thou shalt not, also entails then positives, meaning that it is enshrining a principle that should be positively obeyed in various ways, that the law can both be something that we break because of omission, what we don't do, and commission, what we do do, that the law pertains not just outwardly to things that we see around us with our eyes, but inwardly to our hearts, that it pertains publicly and privately, right? That it pertains in different ways to the duties of what they call inferiors and superiors, which just means people lower or higher in some organizational structure, right? So parents are over children. And so the sins of parents and how the commandment applies to them can be somewhat different than the sins of the children and how that applies to them, or employer-employee relationships, etc. And it has these, what I actually think are quite beautiful overarching categories that it thinks in terms of that help us.
It gives you a way to think about it.
Yeah. Think through the details of the actual true application of God's word to our lives, which infiltrates in a good way, helps us in all aspects of life. And so again, whatever else may be said, there's a tremendous value in learning to think this way. I teach the students here, I try to learn to expound in sermons in terms of trying to show the relevance and significance, or you might say the application of the text in a sermon, to think about such things. These are helpful categories to think about as we explore the bearing of God's word upon our lives.
Indeed. There are so many ways we could go with this here. Maybe just to say this, that one thing, of course, the Catechism is very much a reformational document. So it has a wonderful expression of what is really foundational to everything in terms of the application of the benefits of Christ to us, the benefits of Christ to us, which is we're in union, we're in faith union with Christ, and thus we have justification, right? Adoption, we talked about that in the previous, sanctification. And I will say this, there's a lot I could say, but I want to maybe finish with question 77. So if you work through the questions about what is justification, adoption, and sanctification, including repentance unto life, we come to question 77, which, and we can tip our hats to each other. I believe in the Heidelberg Catechism, question 60 is one of the most remarkable things that has ever been penned on the righteousness that we have before a holy God. Similarly, I have heard my good friend Robert Godfrey mention that question 77, I've heard this more than once, he thinks is the most important question in here or in any catechism. And it is a very important question. Talk about something getting at the heart of the Reformation. And the question is, wherein do justification and sanctification differ? And the answer is, although sanctification be inseparably joined with justification, yet they differ. And that God in justification imputeth the righteousness of Christ. In sanctification, his Spirit infuses grace and enableth to the exercise thereof. In the former, justification, sin is pardoned. In the other, sanctification, it is subdued. The one doth equally free all believers from the revenging wrath of God, and that perfectly in this life, that they never fall into condemnation. That's justification. The other is neither equal in all, nor in this life perfect in any, but growing up to perfection. If that question doesn't entice you to want to dive in and explore the shorter, and especially maybe for the first time, the larger catechism, I think it will.
Well, that does it for our series on the Reformed and Presbyterian Confessions. If you're ever in need of a handy volume where you can have access to all these documents at your fingertips, check out our online bookstore at marsbooksonline.com, where you'll find The Good Confession, Ecumenical Creeds and Reformed Confessions. It's a revised classroom edition put out by Mid-America Reformed Seminary. It's a convenient book that can be a helpful resource for pastors, elders, teachers, and all church members. It includes the Apostles' Creed, Nicene Creed, Athanasian Creed, and of course the Three Forms of Unity and the Westminster Standards. Again, marsbooksonline.com. look for The Good Confession. We're going to switch gears again next week, jumping once more into a series of edifying messages from our faculty. I hope you join us once more for that next time. For more podcast episodes, you can find us on our website at midamerica.edu. We're on YouTube as well. And wherever you listen to your favorite podcasts, be sure to search Mid-America Reformed Seminary's Roundtable. I'm Jared Luchibor. Till next time.